Well, welcome to the 700 Club Interactive. This is the show where we want to hear from you. You can call us, Skype in through a webcam, or send us an email. We have everything that you need to interact with us right on your computer screen. All you have to do is go to CBN.com.
Well, our first story today, we're going to share with you the fact that for many children, Sunday school is the very first place where they hear about Jesus. Maybe that was true for you, but it wasn't the truth for 5-year-old Brittany. She learned about Jesus in her hospital room, where she saw him in person.
Brittany Baconhaster was a precocious 3-year-old.
She knew Bible scripture. She was singing in church all by herself. Just loved life, full of life.
That all changed one morning when her mother, Jamie, heard a strange noise coming from Brittany's room.
Like a gurgling, like a can't breathe, struggling noise. I immediately just picked her up and said, "Oh God, touch her."
Brittany was having a grand mal seizure. Her parents rushed her to the doctor, and Brittany was diagnosed with epilepsy, a condition all too familiar to Jamie.
I understood it because I had them myself. So I thought she'd be just like me. I'd get her on medicine and everything would be all right.
It wasn't that simple. Brittany's doctor started her on the first of many medications, but the seizures just got worse.
She couldn't sit up and she couldn't look at me to focus. And when I call her name, she was just totally out of it, just totally gone. As a mother, you feel so responsible. They're your flesh. They've lived in you. And when she would pull at me to help her, and I couldn't, I blamed myself a lot. You know, I thought, well, I've given my daughter this sickness.
Over the course of the next 2 years, Brittany's illness took its toll on her parents.
Physically, spiritually, mentally, emotionally, even financially. One bottle of medication would cost $50, and we couldn't afford it.
She needed 24-hour-a-day care. I mean, it didn't matter if it's night or day, the seizures continued.
Brittany had to wear a helmet to protect her head from injury, while her parents turned to God's Word for comfort.
God gave me my promise. In Psalms 37, 4 and 5, He said, "Delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thine heart." God said, "Don't look at what you see, look at what you don't see. Tell me and speak what you want." I put her in the car and I started down the road and I ended up at a school playground. And I said, "God, that's what I want. I want my little girl back, normal, like those kids I see that's running and playing." And He said, "It will come to pass."
The doctors, on the other hand, gave a different report.
She had been in the hospital for almost 3 weeks and they had tried everything. They ran one more brain wave and they said her whole brain's seizuring. So we can't even take out the part of the brain or put a shunt in or to help her. There's nothing else we can do. They just said, just let her go home where she'll be more peaceful in her own bed. I just knew she was close to death. And I thought, Lord, it's not time because you said that He would bring it to pass.
Jamie spent a sleepless night praying for her daughter's recovery. That morning, Brittany began to speak.
She kept saying, "Jesus, Jesus." And I could tell by the look on her face and her eyes that, well, she's responding, and she hasn't responded or talked to me for a good year at all. So, you know, when she could look at me and describe Jesus, you know, with eyes like fire and the bright lights and the angels. Who could tell a 5-year-old child that? I knew that she had encountered Christ.
When they took Brittany back to the doctor,
they were amazed. They just looked at her and pretty much just said the same thing, that we see the healing in her eyes. And they knew that. They just, one of the nurses said, "It's a higher power." And I said, "Yeah, it's Jesus. He healed her."
A couple of months after Brittany was healed, Jamie began having headaches.
My doctor thought it was just the stress I went through. But every time I'd take my medicine, my headaches would be stronger.
Jamie's neurologist performed an EEG and found out why.
He said, "A miracle's taken place. Your brainwave's now clear. Would you like to come off your medicine?" And sure enough, I did. And I have been seizure-free and drug-free for 18 years.
Brittany is now in college, studying to be a psychologist. She still loves to sing in church.
The Lord is my helper. I will not fear.
And she still remembers her encounter with Jesus Christ.
Just had the glory of God shone upon him, and the angels were all around him. Front, behind, everywhere, there was angels. And it was just wonderful. You just felt so peaceful and so at ease. And all I can say is there's nothing like it. And I've never experienced anything like it on this earth.
Today, both Brittany and her mother are completely healthy.
I had heard from God, and God kept his promise. And he will, and he does.
God does keep his promise.
Wow.
It's incredible. What an incredible story. That same miracle power is available to you. It is available to you. Jesus loves all of his children. That includes you. You know, if you're a descendant of Adam and Eve, you're a child of God. And just realize that that's you. That's you. And he wants you. And he wants to come and heal you, deliver you, set you free, give you a new outlook on life. He can do it. I don't care how far you've gone down. I love to tell people you can't be too dead for a resurrection. And that can happen to you. I don't care what the doctors are saying. What does Jesus say? And when you have him, you have all the miracle power you need. Now, we're going to pray for people. We've got phone calls already coming in. We've got Jenny on the phone. Jenny's from Maine. Jenny, can you hear me?
Yes, hi.
Hi, how can we pray for you?
Oh, thank you for taking my call, Gordon. I've called into SGS before and been prayed for, but still not working. I have a condition where the doctor says that my mind and body are stuck in the fight-and-flight mode for over a year now, and it's really... kind of making me crazy, and they don't know how to figure it out. They've tried all kinds of medications. They don't work. They either make me sick or they make me worse. I've been to 9 different doctors, including 2 neurologists, and they say it could be some type of injury done by a chiropractor about a year and a half ago. I don't know. They don't know. And I
all
just
right.
need healing. I mean, it's affecting my health. I've lost over 40 pounds. I get all numb all over, and my thinking seems right. It's just my body don't fall into place.
All right. Well, we're going to pray for you, Jenny. And I just have a sense there's something wrong with your adrenal gland.
They've tested that.
I'm sorry?
They've tested that. My cortisol is running super high all day long. But they say the adrenals are functioning normally.
Okay.
I don't know. God knows what's wrong, and he's got to tell somebody or fix me or something.
All right. We're going to agree. We're going to pray for you. We're going to agree, no matter what the problem is, God is the answer. And so we're just going to agree right now. Lord, we just lift Jenny to you. And Lord, for this fight or flight, we just come against it right now in Jesus' name. And Lord, I just ask for your perfect love to come into Jenny's body right now. And I don't care what the problem is. If it's in the adrenal gland, we just ask for that to be healed. Whatever is producing extra cortisol, we just ask that it would be healed now. And I just ask for your perfect peace to come to Jenny. And Lord, just show her how much you love her right now. And just let your love just come on her, your peace just come on her. And it would just take all this fear, all this anxiety, all this trouble away now. In Jesus' name, amen. Terry, is God saying anything to you?
Jenny, I just feel like, I don't know what you're feeling right now, but I just sense that like all of that pent-up nervous energy has just dropped right out of you. It's just gone now, and the peace of God has come upon you. And just, I just pray, Lord, that you would bring balance to her system. You are a God of balance. And so, Father, set everything aright, even as you created her perfectly. Now bring it all back together. And Ginny, we just pray for the peace of God to be in your heart and to surround you, and that you would have that sense that you know that you know that you know that you've been touched by the power of the Spirit of God today, and that your condition will not be the same, that it's gone, that God has taken that and done away with it. Jesus took that upon himself.
Yes.
And it's finished.
Ginny, you feel any better?
Hard to say. I've been wired for over a year, and I don't even know if I remember how I used to feel now.
All right.
Yeah.
Well, go lay down and just ask for more of that peace to come on you.
It's been like living in hell for a year.
Yeah, I bet it has.
Mm-hmm. It's
I'm a real believer in just soaking in the presence of God.
Yeah.
So just go lay down and just ask for more of that peace to come on you. Mm-hmm. And let his peace and his love come into you now.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next caller is Gidget. I'm going to get Bishop Stallings to pray for her. Gidget, how can we pray for you?
Hi. I want to pray for my son, Sean Gillespie.
Uh-huh.
I believe we prayed before for emotional healing and peace and all this. And, you know, I see the Lord doing a great work. I just want to ask now for his emotional and mental stability. He's going to be 9. And, like, he went through some things in the past, trauma, mm-hmm. you know, the father and everything like that. When things were good, they're very good. When they're bad, harmful things were said. And I believe we prayed for, you know, healing and memories. I believe all that. I don't know, like, how he responds. I know that things that aren't done in the spiritual realm sometimes are not manifested.
Mm-hmm.
So, but, you know, I renounce fear almost daily, because it's like as soon as I see that my husband's sober, things are going good. And, you know, I just want to break the pattern of what caused this, even a bad habit, even if this is Sean's way of how he used to react, because 1 year he was dealing with anger when he found out his father was drinking again.
Mm.
Next year was the OCD. Even a psychologist can't believe how bad he was and how good he is now. And, you know, like I said, I owe all to God.
All right. He who has begun a good work is able to finish it in Sean. So.
I just, because, you know, with his friends, like, he has good friends in school, mm-hmm. but, you know, he really doesn't have that many friends outside of school. And I kept him from some play dates because he wasn't quite himself these last 2 years. And I just felt bad. This morning he was getting a little bit mouthy. I don't know what's the age. I don't know what his boot went through. But, yeah, I know the Lord will complete the good work he started. I just want to really lift this up and just say, renew his mind, transform his mind, that he doesn't even remember how to respond to those negative ways, and to build up his self-esteem.
Right.
Whatever more he needs healing or deliverance for, God knows. He'll just do it for him.
All right, Gidget. Bishop Stallings is going to pray for Sean.
Thank you.
Father, we lift up Sean and also his mother, Gidget, for the things that have been transpiring within this life. Lord, your presence to be made known, a tangible
yes.
presence to bring forth mm-hmm. a peace. Father, we ask that you release your angels into the place where he's at right now, ministering fiery angels to bring a comfort and a joy unspeakable and full of glory. We honor you for that, Father. And Lord, I thank you that he is now at a point of contact, and also Gidget, recognizing out of everything that has been done, you do all things well. Thank you for perfecting what you have started. Thank you for bringing an expected end. And we glorify you, and we are rejoicing that this has been settled forever in heaven. Mm-hmm. Kingdom of heaven manifested right now in their home. And nothing shall by any means hurt you. For no weapon that is formed against thee shall prosper. And this is your heritage. Receive it right now in Jesus' name.
Thanks for calling, Gidget.
Thank you so much for being there.
Thank you. All right, we're going to be back after this break. We're going to have Stephen Strader. He's the pastor of Ignited Church in Lakeland, Florida, where the revival broke out last year. If you've got questions about Lakeland, questions about revival, questions about manifestation, just go into the chat room or email us. All the tools are available on the screen at cbn.com. We'll be back right after this.
The doctor came in. I was still waking up from anesthesia. He leaned over my bed and he said, "Laura, you have cancer." And he walked out of the room. The first thought is, what's going to happen to my children?
It's pretty rare for a person as young as me to get Hodgkin's disease. Well, you would think, am I going to be here next year? Am I going to be able to spend more time with my family? And that was really hard.
The doctor says I would like to have his wife, his pastor, and his two best friends present. Then you know you're about to receive really bad news. There was very little hope given to us.
I just wanted this cancer out of me. I wanted to take care of it and move on.
We saw an ad on TV for Cancer Treatment Centers of America. And when I called them, I was very surprised that they were so quick to help us.
The second that we walked through the door, I knew that was the place that I wanted to be. If it wasn't for their kindness and giving, it would be unbearable to be able to go through something like that. And I honestly don't know how people who don't get that are able to handle it.
We were looking for medical care that would help us fight cancer, not manage it, but to actually fight it and beat it. And that's what we found.
Most people thought that that was a death sentence. I knew that I wanted to fight this. I knew I wasn't going to let that happen to me.
If you're a winner and you're a fighter and you're strong, you're going to stay that way. Your mental makeup, your attitude that you've taken your whole life with you, you're going to keep that attitude.
I said, let's just do it, you know, and let me go on with my life.
Call now and we'll send you this free DVD that shows you how the most compassionate group of people anywhere puts you at the center of everything we do. Advanced medical treatment combined with unique supportive therapies give you treatment options you may not even know exist.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America is the way of the future. Patients are now taking control of their own healthcare destiny.
I truly wondered when he had cancer if I would ever get him back. Thanks to Cancer Treatment Centers of America, I have my husband back.
You know, God wants to touch us, and once he does that, he wants to use us in his kingdom purposes. And that's why we like to share with you the opportunity you have to touch the world through Orphans Promise. If you have children, then you know how quickly the laundry can pile up. Well, imagine this, having 100 children, most of them in diapers, and no washing machine. That was the case in one Ukrainian orphanage that I visited. Take a look.
When the police found Sasha, he was just 6 weeks old. He was wrapped in filthy rags and a diaper. Well, he didn't actually have one. His alcoholic mother was lying next to him in the alley, so the police took Sasha away to a clean, safe place.
They brought him here, to this orphanage in Ukraine, where the staff surrounded the little boy with love. They were surprised by the degree of his mother's neglect.
This baby was found in the street. At hospital, he was diagnosed with severe skin condition and pneumonia.
Recently, this home for nearly 100 abandoned or orphaned babies happened upon a very tough situation. The laundry for all of the children began piling up after their commercial-sized washing machine broke down.
We have to change their clothes, their diapers, and the sheets on their beds very often.
And after that large capacity machine broke down, staff members had to wash 500 pounds of laundry a day, some of it by hand. The director of the home was desperate, but she didn't call the government for help. She called Operation Blessing and a special new program called Orphans Promise, which gave the orphanage a brand new state-of-the-art commercial-size washing machine. I was there at the orphanage with CBN partners when we presented it to the staff, and what a difference the washing machine is making. And as for baby Sasha, well, he's just as happy as can be with all the attention he's getting now that the staff doesn't have to work so hard doing the laundry.
Thanks to this wonderful washing machine, we can spend more time with our children. And we are so thankful to such a wonderful present for our baby home.
Isn't it great to know that we can touch people on the other side of the world like that? We make such a difference when we all work together, so we want to invite you to be a part of Orphans Promise. You can do that by calling 1-888-777-1999, or you can log on to cbn.com. But touch these children. They are on the heart of the Lord Himself, and when we touch them, it's as though we've touched Him. So we welcome you to the work of Orphans Promise, and go to cbn.com, find out more about it.
All right, we've got a great pleasure of having our guest, Stephen Strader, with us. He's from Ignited Church in Lakeland, Florida. Welcome.
It's good to be with you. And, you know, this is exciting for me because one of the hallmarks of the Lakeland outpouring was that, like, the second or third day, we went live on the Internet. Right. And we started doing interactive. People were being healed in the chat rooms over emails. One of the most dramatic healings, I talk about it in my book, was over in the email.
Really?
I responded to a lady. She was healed the moment she read the email. One night we experimented. We said, everybody watching right now, send us an email. We had 60,000 emails in just a few hours. It was unbelievable. And we had 7,000 people in the chat rooms. People were ministering to each other. Deliverances, people baptized in the Holy Spirit, healings. All in the chat room. So this is exciting, being on interactive television.
So you've already done all this. This is all...
Well, I'll tell you a little something that you don't know about me. When I left Oral Roberts University in 77, I started working for a film crew in Florida, and I've actually produced segments for the 700 Club.
I did not know.
Yes, and I was a Christian television producer for about 17 years. In 1993, Rodney Howard Brown came to our church. I was the television producer. I produced all the videos and everything.
Were you the pastor, too?
Well, my dad was the senior pastor. Okay. I was the associate. Mm-hmm. And I produced all the television shows that went all over the world. And about the second week into that outpouring, I was directing the television. And I said, you know, I'm going to miss this outpouring. And so I hired another director, and I went and sat on the second row. I got hit by the power of God. Mm-hmm. And from that point on, I went from behind the cameras to in front of the cameras. And now I've been all over the world traveling, doing revivals. I'm here in Virginia Beach this week doing a revival for Jacob Martin at the Hope Center. So my life was totally changed. So when the outpouring hit us in April of 2008, I knew what to do. We got right on the Internet. Within days, we had 50,000 viewers on Internet. And upwards of, they told us upwards of 150,000 over the time. They actually logged the IP addresses. God.TV picked us up, started airing us live. So we were live 5 hours a day, 7 days a week by satellite, upwards of 40 million viewers. We would have anywhere from 30 to 50,000 watching us on the webcast, just like they're watching right now. And it literally took me, I hired three secretaries. It took them 3 months just to answer all the emails.
Wow.
And they were all prayer requests, and they would pray over each email and send them back. Mm-hmm. They call it a media revival because never before in history had a revival played out live on television and on Internet. It never happened before because, as you know, most everything is pre-produced or packaged. Mm-hmm. But it was raw.
It's really rare to get live television anymore.
Yeah, it was raw.
I like producing live. This show's done live. I really like that. I like the immediacy of it.
By the way, happy birthday. Copy of my new book,
you.
The Lakeland Outpouring. I heard it's your birthday this week.
Yeah.
29 again.
Yeah.
29 again.
Don't you believe it.
And what's unique about the book is, you know, I tell the whole story because, you know, the media has totally distorted. By the way, thank you for the outstanding work your film crew did. You came down, covered the story, and your best story was the one of Catherine, the lady that was healed. She was watching the webcast, was healed, dramatically healed, had rods in her hips and in her back, was on three huge pain medications. She drove herself all the way from Miami to Lakeland to get healed and was healed in my service. I did the morning services. The evangelist did the night services. But In the book, I put all the pictures so people can see. You know, we started in my little church to seat 700, and with overflow, I could get 1,200. But by the third day, we had 1,500, and we were having to lock the doors to keep people from coming in. Mm-hmm. I set up TV screens out front of the church. I have a beautiful patio area. So we had 500-600 people out in the patio, spilled out into the parking lots. People had to park a mile away to get in. McDonald's and the pharmacy and different places around us were complaining because our people were taking up their parking spots. So we moved to my brother-in-law's church just down the road about 20 minutes. He seats 3,000. We filled that up the second night. So then we moved to the Civic Center Arena that seats 8,000. We filled it up the second or third night. We moved to the Tigers Baseball Stadium, seats 12,000. Filled it up the first night and had anywhere from 5,000 to 10,000 people stuck on the highway, caused a traffic jam for miles.
Oh, it was a phenomenon.
It was unbelievable.
People came from all over the world, and
40% of the crowd was
watching it, and just amazed when they'd say, "Where are people from?"
Yeah.
And you'd hear Norway shouted out, or people from Australia,
countries.
And it was incredible. But what happened after all the stuff with Todd Bentley came mm-hmm. out? And, I mean, here you have this giant train wreck. Did you see that coming? Was any
not
of that...
Not a clue.
Any of that disclosed to you what was going on in his personal life?
And it was funny because everybody thought because I was the senior pastor, I knew what was going on. Mm-hmm. But I was in this heavenly bubble. I didn't... And I know this is hard to explain, but I had no temptation. Things that would normally cause me frustration or anger. I was in this bubble of grace because we were going 7 days a week, thousands of people coming, and I was responsible for the morning service. So I really had no contact with Todd.
Did fatigue play any role in what happened with him? Or is that...
After the first 60 days, it hit my body, mm-hmm. and I became too sick to go to the healing meeting. I went to bed.
Charles Finney warned of it.
He led the second great awakening.
He said the biggest enemy of revival is the leadership getting tired.
But after the first 60 days, I started taking Saturdays off, and Todd started taking Mondays off. Todd actually turned the whole thing over to me on August 6th. And I didn't find out about Todd until August 12th. He was already gone when it all hit the fan. I took it the last 2 months without knowing anything about it.
We've only got a few seconds left. Quickly, how are you seeing God work this together for good?
It's been awesome. It hasn't been a train wreck for us. Mm-hmm. And the anointing is still there. I still have people coming. And just since April of this year, the anointing level has now gone back up to outpouring levels like we had the last 2 months. Mm-hmm. So on a scale of 1 to 10, the outpouring was like an 11. But then the last 2 months, it went down to a 6 or 7. And that's where we are right now. And it's growing every week. Mm-hmm. It's really exciting.
All right, see. Keep on in revival. You know, my prayer is that, this all get back on track and not focused on one individual, but focused back on Jesus. We leave you with these words. Let all those who rejoice put their trust in you. Let them ever shout for joy. God bless you. We'll see you again.